Please join me in prayer before I read the passage for this evening. Let's pray. Lord, we pray that you send your Spirit to keep us from being apathetic or indifferent to your word. Make your word alive to us, not through some fancy gyrations that we engage in, but through your Spirit opening our hearts and making that word a fire that burns within us. Be with us now as we attend to it, that we may be changed and renewed. In Christ's name, amen. So the passage for this evening is another parable of Jesus on a similar theme, slightly different perspective than this morning. It's from Luke chapter 16, beginning with verse 19. Luke chapter 16, beginning with verse 19. Please turn to your Bibles, turn to your Pew Bibles, or a Bible app if you have it. Luke 16. Jesus is speaking these words. There was a rich man who was dressed in purple and fine linen and lived in luxury every day. At his gate was laid a beggar named Lazarus, covered with sores and longing to eat what fell from the rich man's table. Even the dogs came and licked his sores. The time came when the beggar died and the angels carried him to Abraham's side. The rich man also died and was buried. In hell, where he was in torment, he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side. So he called to him, "Father Abraham, have pity on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and to cool my tongue because I am in agony in this fire." But Abraham replied, "Son, remember that in your lifetime you received your good things while Lazarus received bad things. But now he is comforted here, and you are in agony. And besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been fixed, so that those who want to go from here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross over from there to us." He answered, "Then I beg you, Father, send Lazarus to my father's house, for I have five brothers. Let him warn them so that they will not also come to this place of torment." Abraham replied, "They have Moses and the prophets. Let them listen to them." "No, Father Abraham," he said, "but if someone from the dead comes to them, they will repent." He said to them, "If they do not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be convinced, even if someone rises from the dead." This is the word of our God. Some of you may remember the musical, the Broadway musical that was made into a movie called Fiddler on the Roof. Fiddler on the Roof is the story of a Jewish family in Russia. I think it's in the 19th century. And Tevye, who is the patriarch of the family, has three daughters. And he's a peasant. He has to work hard to survive in his life on his farm and the produce he sells. And at the beginning of the movie, I think the same as in the musical, Tevye sings a song called "If I Were a Rich Man." Now, I'm not going to sing you the song, but I'm going to read you some of the lyrics of the song. He sings, "Dear God, you made many, many poor people. I realize, of course, that it's no shame to be poor, but it's no great honor either. So what would have been so terrible if I had a small fortune? And then the chorus is, "If I were a rich man, I wouldn't have to work hard," and so on. He says, "I'd build a tall house with rooms by the dozen, right in the middle of the town. A fine tin roof with real wooden windows below. There would be one long staircase just going up, and one even longer coming down, and one leading nowhere just for show. I see my wife Golda looking like a rich man's wife with a proper double chin." In other words, she'd have more than enough to eat, right? "Supervising meals to her heart's delight. I see her putting on airs and strutting like a peacock. Oy, what a happy mood she's in, screaming at the servants day and night. The most important men in town would come to fawn on me. They would ask me to advise them, like a Solomon the wise. If you please, Reb Tevye, pardon me, Reb Tevye, posing problems that would cross a rabbi's eyes. And it wouldn't make one bit of difference if I answered right or wrong. When you're rich, they think you really know. And then the song ends with these words. Lord, who made the lion and the lamb, you decreed I should be what I am. Would it spoil some vast eternal plan if I were a wealthy man? Now, of course, it's sort of done tongue-in-cheek. It's done humorously, but it's the cry of a poor man who looks to God and asks, why couldn't I have been born into a rich family? Why couldn't I have more than just enough to scrape by on? Isn't that what the good life is about? Well, Jesus tells a parable about what the good life is really about and what a fulfilled life is about. And he tells the parable contrasting two men, one who is wealthy and a lover of money because of the many things it gave him, and the other, a parable of a poor man who sits out just outside of his home begging. And I want to suggest to you that in this parable, Jesus, God's Word, wants us to teach us this. That the kingdom of God challenges the values of this world and replaces them with the values of God's kingdom. That is, the values of knowing God, loving and serving Him with a humble heart. So the first thing we see in this parable is that a man's status in this world is not the same as their status in God's kingdom. The parable speaks of two men. One was very rich, who enjoyed the things that riches buy. He had fine clothes. He's described as dressed in purple, which was very expensive, what very rich people wore, with white linen underneath his beautiful purple robes. He had banquets of sumptuous food, the freshest and the tastiest that money could buy. And he had a luxurious home, a large home with a gate, which means there was a significant property around the home, likely a large estate. That's one man. On the other hand, there's the man, the poor man, Lazarus, sitting at the gate. He's clothed, not with beautiful, fine clothes, but with sores, which the parable tells us that the dogs in the town would come and lick. He has to beg for food, and he longs for the scraps from the table of the rich man's banquet. He apparently has no home, what we today would call he'd be a homeless man, and has to lie outside the gate of the rich man's estate, and he's begging for help, begging for money, begging for food. The rich man is fat, well-dressed, comfortable. Lazarus is thin, covered in rags and sores, probably wet, cold, dirty, even smelly outside. We're told that the rich man walked in and out of his gate of his estate every day in his various businesses. He passed right by Lazarus with his great needs, probably stepped over him at times. He had much to give, but in the parable, he's described as giving nothing. Nothing to help Lazarus in his hunger, in his thirst, in his sickness, in his cold, and in his suffering. A selfish rich man who shows no compassion for the poor and the needy. And if he was a Jew, he was supposed to show compassion for the poor and the needy in the community. And it's almost this determined effort to ignore the needy man literally under his feet as he's traveling in and out of his home through the gate. If God gives some more, the Bible clearly says that what they have more of, they are to help those who have less. John Calvin says it even stronger. He says, God gives the rich more so that they will use their riches to help the poor. And of course, we don't have to look far. I mean, there are many people in need around the world, in the developing world, but there's many in need right around us, right under our feet in our communities. And often we just need to open our eyes to see those that are needy right in front of us. And that's what we're called to. So the parable says that both die. But in contrast to their status in life, their status changes after death. In the sense, what we see is their true status, that is their status before the eyes of God. Lazarus, this poor, neglected, sick, hungry, homeless man, is welcomed into God's presence. You might say his eternal house. In fact, he is described as being in the bosom of Abraham. Abraham, this man who believed God and was credited to him as righteousness, who's even called a friend of God in the Bible. So to be at Abraham's side is to be in God's presence, is in a sense to be also considered righteous in God's sight, and to be a friend of God, comforted by God's love. In contrast, the rich man goes to the place of torment, in hell, or Hades is often what it says in the Greek, where there's great suffering and agony. And as he looked up and saw Abraham far away with Lazarus by his side, we read that he longed to be where Lazarus was. He longed to have his thirst quenched, that Lazarus might dip his finger in a drop of water and put it on his tongue to relieve his torment and his thirst. So what this describes for us is a great chasm between the two. We saw a great chasm between the two in the parable in life, but now, after their lives end in this world, the chasm is greater because one is in the presence of God, finding rest with him, and one is absent from God, experiencing torment. And the gap is very great, as in the parable, Abraham says that there is no way to cross that chasm. Lazarus can't go to the rich man, and the rich man can't go to Lazarus. So now we see there's two status. We see from God's perspective, that's what Jesus is telling us. We see from God's perspective what status of these people truly is, as opposed to how they look in this life. And so secondly, what Jesus is telling us in this parable is that our status before God comes from our knowing him and seeing our proper place in his kingdom. So you might think of the status, proper understanding of the status is answering, an answer to this question. What's at the center of each man's world? What is the values that each man lives for? Well, for the rich man, he's the center of his world. He uses his riches to enjoy the luxurious life on earth, fine clothing, feasting on sumptuous food, luxurious house, great property and wealth. But in the afterlife, interestingly enough, he's still focused on himself. He's still at the center of his world. And he asks Abraham to send Lazarus to his family to warn them, as if Lazarus, he sees Lazarus is still in this lower state. He's supposed to do whatever he says. Jesus warns us of those who love, Jesus warns us of the love that the pagans have, a love for those who will give them back. And Lazarus is still expecting something back. The rich man is still expecting something back from Lazarus because he sort of thinks, well, he has his place and his place is to serve me, even though he didn't do a thing for him. Nowhere is to be seen any concerns of the rich man. He remains in the afterlife what he was in his earthly life, a man selfishly focused on himself. At the center of Lazarus' life is knowing God. Now, how do we know that? Well, because Lazarus, in the parable, accepted his lot as a poor and suffering man. I suppose in some ways he reminds us of Job in the Old Testament, who experienced extreme loss, loss of children, loss of wealth, but he accepted it from the hand of God. And as Job trusted in God, even in his painful time of struggle after his loss, by implication, Lazarus is the same. In the parable, we hear no words of hate or bitterness against the rich man, or no shaking of his fist against God for his lot. In other words, he trusts in God, as Job did, even as he cried out to God. He trusts in God. Lazarus, the man of faith, is comforted and welcomed by Abraham, the man of faith. So by implication, he's said to be the same as Abraham, a man who lives by faith, even though he has a very difficult life. He trusted in God as Job did in his painful trials. And that's why he goes to the presence of God after his death. And there's a great chasm, as Abraham says, there's a great chasm between the two, a place of comfort and joy for God's people and a place of torment and selfishness for those who live self-centered lives, not concerned about God, not concerned about serving others, not concerned about using what God has given them to help those in need. In the parable, Abraham makes very clear that there's a sharp distinction that God has made between these two kind of lifestyles. And what is highly esteemed in this world is not highly esteemed by God. I used to watch Dragon's Den. You know, Dragon's Den is these very successful business people, and they have these people coming before them with proposals for business that they want these very successful people to invest in to help them to boost their kingdom or to promote the product. I always mention Kevin O'Leary. He's not on there anymore. I used to call him Mr. Wonderful, but Kevin O'Leary was a Canadian businessman, though he now spends most of his time in the States. He's still on Shark Tank in the States, that similar kind of program. But Kevin O'Leary always used to say to these people who would come before him is, how can I make money on what your proposal is? How can I achieve success from what you have done? It's very much focused on the good life in terms of riches and financial prosperity. Well, that leads to a certain result, as the parable tells us. And the humble man or woman that honors God faithfully, no matter what their economic condition, no matter what their status in life, it's not about what they can get out of it, but how they can serve God. And those are the people with whom God is pleased. So I think what the parable is challenging us with is this, my third point. The focus of our lives should be on the kingdom of God. The focus of our lives should be on the kingdom of God. The final words between the rich man and Abraham in the parable clarify the heart of the matter. And the heart of the matter is truly about knowing God and serving Him. Like the rich man, many see wealth as the achievement of salvation, of having made it, of the rich life. And yet it's not. I came across this quote by Jim Carrey. You know who Jim Carrey is? He's a Canadian. He was a comedian and impersonator, and he went on to be fairly successful in movies and other events. And something's happened with Jim Carrey recently. He's become a spiritual searcher. And there's a famous quote of his. I don't know if you've come across this, but here's the quote that Jim Carrey says. It's sort of out of character because you always think of him as a goofy comedian and he plays these goofy parts in his movies. But here's what Jim Carrey wrote. It's posted online. He says, "I think everyone should get rich and famous and do everything they ever dreamed of so that they can see it's not the answer. It's not the answer." Because Jim Carrey became famous and rich and achieved a lot. He goes on to say, once they attain it, inevitably what happens is you sit there and you think, that's it? That's what all the hype is about? I don't feel happy. I don't feel fulfilled. I don't feel anything. There's a lot of insight in that quote. It's a good place to begin with, a good place to start your spiritual journey. And I hope that that spiritual journey leads Jim Carrey to know Christ and forgiveness and renewal in Him. So turning back to the rich man and Lazarus in this parable, we see that in his desire, in his torment, he least has regard for his family. Now again, family is, I love them, they love me, so it's still a very reciprocal attitude, but he has a desire to send a word of warning to his family, and so he asks the rich man to send somebody back from the dead to his family. Specifically, he says, well, send Lazarus back. That's his plight, right? That's his state in life. He's there to just serve me. And the rich man believes that if someone comes from the dead, that will lead his family to repent of the luxurious life that leads to torment after death, that they might not suffer the same fate that he did. Sounds remarkably similar to Jews' request to Jesus for signs. Signs that would force him to believe, even though he'd given abundant signs in miracles and abundant signs in his teaching, showing that he fulfilled the Old Testament prophecies about the Messiah. So the rich man thinks that if his family gets shocked by some spectacular supernatural sign, they will repent. Would they? The Gospel of John tells us that when a man was born blind, blind all his life, was healed by Jesus, the Jewish leaders wouldn't accept it. They're looking for some other explanation. It can't be the fact that Jesus healed them. There must be something else going on. And eventually they throw the blind man out when he begins to challenge them. Even when Lazarus is raised from the dead, not the same Lazarus here, but Jesus' friend Lazarus, brother of Mary and Martha, the Jewish leaders, instead of seeing this as a sign that Jesus was the Messiah, John's Gospel tells us they plotted not only to kill Jesus, but to kill Lazarus, to remove the evidence of the miraculous sign. If you're not open to God, you'll find a way to explain it away, even explain away miracles. So it's not about the evidence. It's not about miraculous signs. It's about having a heart that's open to God, really wanting to see and to embrace what God is doing. And this becomes clear in Abraham's response to the request of the rich man. He says to the rich man, well, they have the law and the prophets. They have the Old Testament, God's word, which points to the promise of God's salvation in the Messiah. They have that. They have the living words of God. And if people listen to God's promises in His Word, they would be open to God's Word. They would see that Jesus is indeed the promised one sent by God. They would see that He came to accomplish salvation. It's a word of grace, a work of grace. And they would have faith in Him, faith in the offer of salvation in Jesus Christ. Faith shows itself in a life of gracious love to others. It overflows with the love of God that has been poured into our hearts, and that love flows through us into the lives of others. and is shaped by the thrust of the Bible in pointing us to God's salvation in the gift of His Son. So a true child of God lives by the Word of God. Doesn't need signs and wonders, and doesn't need to go chasing after things or looking for things. If your life is not shaped by God's Word in that way, then not even somebody raised from the dead, not even the Son of God, will cause you to repent. This poor man Lazarus clearly trusted in God in his life, going into the presence of God. The Jews did not change their minds, even when they heard that Jesus rose from the dead. They dismissed it as a story made up by Jesus' disciples. The Gospel of Matthew says that they were bribed by Jewish leaders to say that the apostles came and stole the body in the middle of the night, overpowered them. That wouldn't work. It wouldn't help. It's a hollow request. To be shaped by God's Word is to be directed to Jesus. To know the Law and the Prophets is to know the one to whom they point, the one who laid down His life for His people. To believe in that is to live a life of submission to God and love for others. So this parable is not about God's love for the poor and His hatred of the rich. That's not what it's about. Some people might want to distort it to mean that, but that's not what it's focused on. It's ultimately about what you trust in your life and for eternity. Where is your faith? As Jesus said, where's your treasure? Because that's where your heart is. Where's your treasure? If we trust in God's salvation in Christ with humble and repentant hearts, whatever our circumstances or social status or wealth, there is life ahead of us. That's the status we have. And it's a warning not to fall into the trap of seeing things that the world values as the ultimate source and measure of success and achievement. In Jesus, we find our identity, our security, our significance. And if we see it there, it doesn't matter what the circumstances in our life are. We will be open to the joy and delight of being in the presence of God. So, again, this parable reminds us that Jesus' kingdom challenges the values of this world and replaces them with the values of His kingdom, the values of the gospel, to know Him, to love Him, to trust in Him. So let me conclude by suggesting four things that we learn from this parable. Four things, I think, by way of application. I think what this parable calls us to do is to do a values inventory of our lives. Are our values about primarily growing and knowing and serving God? Are they primarily about making it in the world? We're called to have the values that by implication Lazarus had, to know God, to trust in Him, to be submissive to Him, to believe that we have a future in Him. Secondly, I think we learn that the prosperous need to care for the poor. The rich man in the parable suffers the consequences of ignoring the poor man on his doorstep, and that's a symptom. That outward symptom reveals the cause, a heart that is far from God. This is a message that we need to take to heart today, for we are wealthy by the world's standards. And not, we can't solve all the problems in the world. We can't take all the people in the world out of poverty, but we can do that in our communities. And we can do some of that for others around the world. The second thing that we see here, the third thing, sorry, is that there's no second chance after death. It's in this life, God's Word tells us, that our eternal destinies are determined by the choices that we make, by how we respond to the message of the gospel in Jesus Christ. There's no second chance after we die. The rich man wants to warn his brothers, but really was too late for the rich man and probably too late for his brothers. Because they're moving in the same path that the rich man did. And finally, we see that God's word is sufficient for our faith. So many today, sadly, so many Christians are running around looking for signs or miracles or special experiences to live faithfully before God, to live for the purposes of His kingdom. We don't need to chase after these special events, these unusual occurrences. Miracles may strengthen and enrich our faith, but they don't produce faith. Jesus makes it clear that Scripture is decisive for our faith. All that we need for faith and life is found in the Word of God. That's what we need to attend to. If we don't attend to that, all these other things, these special experiences, even miracles, they won't be effective in our lives. Attend to the Word of God. Live by the Word of God. Meditate on the Word of God. Pray over the Word of God. Ask God to make that Word effective in our lives. And then we will have the right perspectives in our lives. And then we will live with the right future in mind. So ask God to give you greater faith in His Word, especially when it comes to having kingdom values embedded and manifested in your life. Because then you will know the true riches that are found in Christ, the true riches that we experience to some extent in this age, but we will experience fully in the age to come, to be welcomed in the presence of God, to be in the bosom of Abraham, to know peace and rest. And I pray that that may be your goal and your hope in this life. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for this challenge and this reminder that we need to take the call to have kingdom values embedded and permeating our lives. Thank you for your Spirit that helps us in this. Forgive us when we slide into the mentality that it's not enough. We need to add what the world offers to give us true value and true hope in our lives. So make us students of prayer, students of your word. Help us to delight in the ministry of the church and to work together, encouraging and admonishing and building one another and praying one another so that we may live by your kingdom values. For that gives us fruitfulness not only in this life but in the life to come. Thank you for the promise of the Spirit to enable us to do that. By the strength you give us, help us to be true ambassadors of your kingdom, holding out a light in a dark age. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.